He was putting out all these pandemic recordings he'd made in the place that we all sound like Josh Groban, the place that we all sound best. Because not that Josh Groban needs to sing in the shower to sing beautifully. I mean, you don't sell tens of millions of records by belting out tunes while letting the conditioner do its thing. All that to say that Josh is finally out of the shower, out of the house, and finally back on tour. Now, Josh Groban, if you don't know him, is a musician from Los Angeles who, again, is one of the biggest selling vocal artists of all time. He sold over 25 million records. He's toured to packed audiences all around the world. But for a guy who is considered to have one of the greatest singing voices on earth, can I say he's pretty normal? Likes to talk about aliens and UFOs and all that. Josh Groban joined me the other day from Zoom from one of his tour stops. I hope you dig this. I asked him where he was.
I'm in Detroit, Michigan. Yeah, beautiful Detroit, Michigan. Still showering. I want to make that clear. But just you're not getting as many songs from said shower, which is fine. I'm still singing in the shower. It's just my iPhone is now charging in another room when I do so.
Do you really sing in the shower? Do you really?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it remains the best reverb out there. And also, you know, it's steamy. It's a good place to kind of get to know where your voice is at the beginning of a day, especially if you have a recording session or a show at the end of the day. It's a good place to, yeah, no. And especially if I'm in a hotel room like I am now, you know, everybody down the hall is going to hear my dying seal vocal warm-ups from the shower for sure.
Are you doing this one? Was it that one?
Oh yeah, we do the big C, you know, we do the sirens, we're doing all kinds of things. There's a great YouTube video of an old interview that Pavarotti did on how he like gets ready for a performance, and it made me feel so good because even the greatest pipes that have ever graced this planet, he's like, okay, well, in the morning I try a little bit, and if it doesn't come out, then I have a little food, I take a shower, and then I try again. And if this time it doesn't come out, you force it, you maybe you scream if you have to. And he's like, just step by step by step, trying to get his voice to get where it needs to be. And then he sings an aria, but he says, oh, but it, then on your drive to the venue, maybe it goes away. So then you have to do it again at the venue. And I'm thinking, okay, great. We're all nuts. We're all crazy. And, you know, it doesn't come easily. It's, you know, you try to make it look easy out there, but it's a long maze of demons you get to in order to sing all right.
Well, I mean, speaking of a long maze of demons, I've been thinking a little bit about the record you put out during the pandemic, the Harmony record, and you and I.
Long Maze of Demons.
Yeah. Long Maze of Demons. It was a rare really black metal record from you.
For album titles.
I didn't think you'd have black metal in yet, but I got to say, it did really well.
I feel like that was a missed opportunity for the Rick Rubin album that I did to call that long maze of demons. We went for a decidedly more positive title than Harmony.
Well, you know what? I'm not here to manage you, but you know, if you need any advice, you know where to find me. Do you hear that record now, that pandemic-y record now, differently now that we're getting past it?
Yes, it is the Tiger King of music to me now. It's The amazing thing about that album was that it was both an incredible and cathartic, therapeutic kind of collection of sessions that we did to make that album happen. Because, you know, it's not every day that you're recording, and every session you set up, you can't believe that you have the opportunity to even do the session. I've had 20 years where my next 2 years have been planned out within an inch of his life. And so to have an opportunity to sing these songs that I've loved forever. And a lot of these songs came about because the comment section for as long as social media has been around has blown up about please sing this song or that song. And I've collected songs that I've just wanted to do for a long time. But we utilized the technology that's available to us now to be able to have a 10-foot spread out orchestra in London, a producer in Nashville, a bassist in New York. I'm in my bedroom. A lot of these vocals I did in my bedroom. You know, so it was a process that I'd like to not have to do again, but the fact that we were able to actually kind of not just survive it artistically, but thrive through it was something I'll never forget.
How did it feel the first time you went back on stage after all that forced time off?
You know, it was interesting because we were out there just enjoying playing and there was nothing else around it. We weren't thinking about promoting anything. We weren't thinking about anything that had to do with the hamster wheel of whatever the cycle of an album and a tour and a promo schedule and all that stuff has to do in normal days. We just decided, I think, collectively as a band and just getting together, to just kind of view it very casually in the best possible way, to just kind of say, don't overthink it in the moment. Don't overcriticize. Don't think about anything except just enjoying stepping up on that stage, looking out at those people, and let the night be what it's going to be. And I think if there's any silver linings that have come from this otherwise super traumatic couple of years, I think so many of us kind of have that don't sweat things that don't need worrying about mentality right now, which is just to have some perspective on what it's all about. And so a little bit of, yes, the emotions were there, the excitement was there, but the nerves strangely weren't there. It was just kind of like, let's just go have a great time because there's big things happening in the world and this is not one of them. So let's have a great time.
Were you an overthinker before the pandemic for your performances?
Well, yeah. I mean, there's always carryover. You know, we're all stunted at the day we got famous, like every one of us. And so, like, you know, if I got shot out of a cannon as an angsty 17-year-old kid who was told every single day of his life, if you don't do this, sing this, look like this, go there, then it's going to get passed over. You know, it's, you're constantly battling, like, loving what you do and also being consistently terrified of it going away for a good portion of your young career. So, you know, as I've gotten older, I mean, a lot of this I grew out of anyway, but there's nothing like the grading curve of everybody having to time out at the exact same time and go through this collectively. I think that can have a positive influence on the artistic process for a lot of people, because there is a lot of unnecessary stuff that gets in the way of doing your best, most honest stuff. And most importantly, just enjoying it, smelling the roses, having a 32,000 foot view that says, hey, this is all right. You're doing great. And they're loving it and you're loving it. And this is a really good time. If you're an overthinker and you're still wrapped around all that neurosis, I think I share that probably with a lot of other performers. There's a lot that can get in the way of you enjoying it. And so I think the perspective of the last couple of years has given me a much more relaxed approach to just allowing myself to just have fun and just let these evenings and let these songs be everything that they want to be.
I can't imagine, Josh, like what you had to go through when you were 17 years old. I mean, and I should mention that Canada, given this is a Canadian show, plays a big part in the story. Can we take a listen
Huge.
To the thing?
I was in a panic. So when I called Josh and he said, well, I can't sing it in that key. I really had to do some fast thinking. I said, you know, yeah, you really can, Josh. He said, no, I really can't. I said, Josh, I'm telling you right now, you can sing it in that key. Get down here right now. You cannot let me down on this.
And the sermon comes on stage, almost going backward. He was so scared. He was going forward, but he was so shoulders like this and scared. So I see this young kid and I'm like, okay, sure. And do you know the song? He said, yeah, I think I do. He took the microphone and when he started to sing, he couldn't be any more powerful than that.
That's the legendary Canadian producer David Foster and the legendary Canadian singer Celine Dion talking about the first time they met my guest, Josh Groban. You know, this is our third time talking. I've never asked you to tell me that story. Can I get you to tell me that story?
Sure. Yeah. It's you know, it's even now 22 years after that experience, you know, yes. I mean, truly, like you said, I have great Canadians to thank for being here, talking about it. But you know, that was a almost pre-internet kind of serendipitous moment that is very old school. I don't think they happen like that anymore. We have American Idol. Now we have the TV shows that are giving great young singers those opportunities all the time. But at the time that happened, the happenstance that needed to occur to for the stars to align, for David to have gotten five or six tapes from a voice teacher that he knew at the time, picking mine, choosing me for a charity event, 3 weeks later saying, hey, you were great at that event. I've got this song called The Prayer. Meanwhile, I was a junior in high school. So I was doing homework and thinking about whether or not I could make the school play. And, he said, I'm going to be going to the Grammys. Andrea Bocelli is stuck in Germany. His flight is delayed. So, can you come and sing this song, The Prayer, with Celine Dion? And, you know, I didn't have stars in my eyes.
That's insane.
It's insane.
That's insane.
It's insane.
I want to recap. If you missed it, he's 16 years old, or some 16, 17 years old. He sings at a tape, gets to David Foster to sing at some charity event. Andrea Bocelli's flight gets delayed, and you get brought in to sing at the Grammys with Celine Dion. That's insane.
This is a Star Is Born in like 17-year-old geeky baritone boy world. Like this is Bradley Cooper was rolling down his window to just get a look at me one more time. It was a crazy experience, and I'm an LA kid, but I did not grow up in a showbiz family. So, you know, for me, like being somebody who was very, you know, I had my head in the clouds. I did not have stars in my eyes. I was not looking for pop stardom. I wanted to be like the great musical theater baritones that I grew up listening to. And so when someone like David Foster says, come sing this song that's like 10 keys higher than anything you're singing in high school. And the only thing that I was thinking was, can I do a good job? And am I going to fall on my face at this thing? And so I said, no. I said, David, I don't think I'm the right singer for this, but I really appreciate you asking me. And it's beautiful, but thank you. But I don't think I can knock it out of the park the way you want. And it's like David said, he said, and I hung up, and my parents kind of said, well, what was that? And I told them who it was and what he was asking. And they're like, oh, what did you say? I said, well, I said, no, I've got, you know, I don't know if I can do it right. And they're like, oh, okay, sure, Josh, whatever makes you feel comfortable. David called me back. Thankfully, I'm here because David called me back, and he said, I don't think you computed what I was telling you on the phone. Get your ass to the Shrine Auditorium. I'll see you at 3:00. And like, I think he, you know, at this point, 15 Grammys, like, I don't think he'd ever heard somebody turn down an opportunity like that before. He'd never met anybody as dumb as me. And, but I think that blissful ignorance actually worked to my advantage, because I wasn't like out to get something. I wasn't thinking to myself, well, this might lead to a record deal. I was just thinking, God, I really hope I don't F up and I can get back to school and with my head held high, you know? And I had no idea what those moments would lead to. And the fact that, that day would lead to so many full circle moments. I got to sing that song with Bocelli on the Grammy telecast 10 years later. I just got to share the bill with Celine in Hyde Park in London right before the lockdown. It's been an insane journey since then. I never get tired of it.
Does Bocelli call you after that? Like after you do his gig, because his flights, does he call you and go like, hey, good job, or you know?
I'm still not entirely sure Bocelli was told what happened. I'm not sure he knows who I am. No, he does, of course. We've sung together since then. He's been nothing but gracious. He's been nothing but lovely. And of course, you know, in high school, that was when his Romanza album had just come out, and everybody who was a vocalist just said, who is this guy? This voice is just giving us all goosebumps. And so to have been a part of, you know, for him to have been a part of the very, very nucleus of my career, and for me to have been, you know, in his orbit at the very, very beginning of what would become such a legendary career for him. It's pretty cool. I'll have a book one day. There's a lot.
Celine's great. Hey, I got to meet her before. She is
great.
Yeah. She's wild and funny.
Yes. So funny. She is what you see. There is such a genuine, there isn't a cynical bone in her body. She is so genuine. She is so passionate about what she does, what she sings, her fans, her collaborators. And I think that I also owe so much to her for having been so cool that day, because I have since Celine met some heroes vocally that were not quite as kind, who shall remain nameless. And so, you know, it's
Fred
one thing
Durst. You can say Fred Durst. It's okay,
it's
Josh.
I've not had the great pleasure of meeting Fred Durst yet.
All right, sure. Go on.
But no, Celine knew I was a nervous wreck. She knew I was in the same position she had been in at that age. and she took my hand and she helped me get through it.
God love her. And well, I think about that in your own story, because I know that passing it on is really important to you. Public arts education is really important to you. You have a foundation that offers grants to underfunded schools for their arts programs. I mean, is that you wanting to give people this the same opportunity that you were somehow miraculously, crazily given?
Yeah, well, the opportunity to do this for a living, all of these crazy fantasy stories of what happened with David and Celine and all that, that was icing on the cake to what was already a life-saving experience, having a great, solid public arts education in school. Whether or not David and Celine had come my way was almost totally inconsequential to the fact that those teachers in my school already saved me in so many ways. I could have gone off and become a veterinarian, and those schools would have still saved me in so many ways. So for me to have experienced firsthand how a solid arts education took me out of my shell and allowed me to communicate clearly and honestly for the first time in my life, it affected everything. It affected my social life. It affected my family life. It affected my grades. It affected my self-confidence and my wanting to share myself with people. And I've seen that occur in so many countless situations in schools across the country. And the stigma about arts ed is it's the drum circle, and it's, you know, macaroni necklaces, and it's not anything, you know, substantial, but it really is. And especially right now, when both budget cuts are happening and also there are more confused and frightened young kids and students than ever out there, the arts infused in a school is a tool to unlock these kids, whatever they go into in their lives. I run into adults who are in the most brainy jobs, and they will pull me aside and they'll say that theater teacher, that music teacher really helped them get through everything and gave them the confidence to go off and be a lawyer or an accountant or whatever it is. So yes, Find Your Light is all about making sure those programs stay alive.
Well, coming from a family of teachers, including music teachers, it's a beautiful thing. Before we go, I heard a story about you that when you were a kid, you were really obsessed with aliens.
Was. Yeah, I'm so glad we're finally seeing these documents released to the public. I used to sit in the window as a 10-year-old and go, "Take me."
You were talking to David Foster, though, about yeah.
David Foster woke up in a cold sweat. And said, "Somebody's just summoned me." He may be an alien. He's so talented.
Yeah,
talented.
It wouldn't surprise me
from here.
Yeah,
but. I watched X-Files like everybody else, the government, U.S. government actually did a cool thing. I wrote them almost as a troll. I wrote the Defense Department as like a 12-year-old, like a long essay about like, I've read about this, that, and the other, and I know that there's been abductions, and this is what the alien colonies are doing on this planet, and they're coming to see us, and time travel is real. I was really like, it was almost fiction. I wrote like a fiction essay to the U.S. government, and they actually, it's like Santa writing you back when he didn't have to. They wrote me back and they said, "Josh, it's very nice to see your interest in space and in all these things. And here we've attached all of the known sightings that we've had that we can't explain. And we hope you enjoy it. And hopefully you'll go into space exploration one day." It was a very kind of like, I'm not sure the government would do that these days, but it was very, very cool. And of course, we're not alone.
I was going to ask, we just had Margaret Atwood on a little while ago, and I got to ask her this question.
Yeah.
Do you believe in aliens?
I have a theory that, and it's not mine alone. I read this on the internet a long time ago, so take it with a grain of salt. But I actually thought there was something to it, which is that, you know, when you hear about abductions and you get these kind of long, slimy, gray creatures with long fingers and little slits for a nose and giant eyes, they still have like the same features that humans do. It's two arms, two legs, fingers, eyes, two slots for a nose. If there was alien life somewhere else, for all intents, we're such a lottery of all the things that had to occur for us to look like we do now. If there was an actual alien race out there, it would probably look entirely different than us. So my feeling is that these abductions are actually coming from like us humans, like a million years in the future. Like that's what we look like after everything that's happened to us, evolution, nuclear wars, all these other things. They're going to take me to the loony bin right now. They're knocking at the door right now.
That's David Foster.
And we've developed time travel, and it's us a million years in the future coming back and like probing 2020. 22 us.
I love that theory that these green X-Files-y people are us from the future.
Yeah.
Trying to
They're
shut
us.
Down the Large
They're
Hadron
us. We've
Collider.
Evolved, like insanely evolved. That's exactly right. And so I don't know. It's fun to see. And it's really fun to see the Defense Department like releasing these tapes of these crafts. They're just like, I don't know what the hell that is. We can't do that. I think there's something going on, and I think it's an interesting time to be alive, and hopefully we'll have some answers while we're still on this planet.
Before we go, I wanted to play a song. But so when you do a set night after night, I know that almost every artist I've talked to who does enough gigs like you do, there's one song they're always looking forward to in the set. For Brandon Flowers from The Killers, I asked him that, and he said, you know what? He said, I don't talk about it very much, but I always look forward to Read My Mind. I know when that's coming, that's going to be a nice little moment for me. What is, I thought we could go out on it, whatever it is. What is that song for you?
Oh, man. That's a really, really good question. I have a song that is a really feel-good song, and it's a collaboration that I did with Kirk Franklin. It's a song that was a song that I needed to write to get through these times. And Kirk Franklin's music is like, it just makes you feel so, so good. He's just infectious. And so I reached out to him and I said, I've got this song. And every time I've performed it, like I'm doing it as much for me as I am for the audience. It's like my chance to like, to get through whatever it is that I needed to get through at that time. And it's called The Fullest. And that's the one I think I'm most looking forward to singing this summer.
I think that's the one we're going to play. Josh, such a joy to talk to you always. I mean, you're such a great guest. I always look forward to having you on.
Same, Tom. Thank you. It's always a pleasure. Thanks for always having me on. And I hope to see you up north soon.
Sky, a spark has finally come to life and washed over me. Steal me from out of this delusive night. I got so much time for wild surprises, I can't hold them anymore. But how much this could mean to me, I can only imagine. How deeply we receive all the colors that we found. Won't you follow me out on thin branches, going blind, trying to soak up the sun? I believe that the space in between is what we become. Battle back through the fourth and the second chances. Gotta fly at the end of the fall. And when my
Josh Groban, along with the gospel legend Kirk Franklin, with a song called The Fullest. Josh Groban just started his North American tour, which includes a stop in Toronto, actually, tomorrow.